a problem in my pathway. I feel I'm frozen here. The doubts are circling high above me, but in the shadow of my feet, the fire of faith is stirring, growing inside of me, reminding me of something I already believe. He's a God of mighty miracles. When the days are dark, I will keep on trusting him. I will not lose heart. No, 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 no. My God, he is a mountain mover. He's gonna make a way. I can hide him. He's gonna make a way.
Mover, would you stand together with us and rejoice that we have faith in a God who has all power, all glory belongs to him. And so when we worship today, we worship with faith, trusting him that as we worship, he is the one who sits on the throne. So we rejoice in him today. Praise him, and we call out to him. Let's call out to him and just say, oh, Lord, we need you. Oh, oh, oh.
Say
trust him because his word is true, and we stand on his word. Follow after me.
I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
All my days I'll live for you.
All my days I'll live for you.
I will stand upon your truth.
I will stand upon your truth.
And all my days I'll live for you.
All my days I'll live.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day.
Trust the Lord with our fears and sorrows. You may be seated.
Amen. This morning we come to rejoice in the God who makes all things possible because he's in control and he has all the power. And today is the day to worship him and praise him corporately as the body of Christ. And so I invite you this morning, perhaps there's something that's of great concern in your life, a big mountain before you, as the choir just sang. He is the mountain mover, and we can praise him today that he's able to work all things together for good in our lives and move that mountain. And maybe you just need to come and lay it here on the altar this morning, or just praise him for how he's moved a mountain in your past. And now you're moving on freely, focused on him, living by faith and trusting in him. We bring our burdens before the Lord because we know he loves us. He calls us to cast all our cares upon him. He loves you and has demonstrated that love, and we celebrate that this morning as well because of the great love we know and have experienced in Jesus Christ. I invite you this morning to come bring your prayer burdens before the Lord and leave them here on the altar, perhaps interceding, praying for someone that God needs to demonstrate even to them that he's able to move that mountain, an impossible situation that may be before them. You and I have the eyes of faith. We've been walking by faith and we've been believing that God is able to do the impossible. And that's why we come to him. And maybe you and I need to intercede for someone this morning that God would just inspire them by our faith to trust in him and put their faith in him. So let's pray to the mountain mover today, and let's leave our burdens with him this morning, and let's celebrate what God is going to do in working through those situations. Pray with me this morning. Almighty, sovereign Father, our lives are in your hands. We know that you are working things together for our good. We know that whatever is before us, Lord God, you are able to make a clear path and make a way. God, we have read in your word how you have done that time and again for your saints. God, we have experienced that in our past. Today we come and we give thanks for your deliverances. We give thanks for your provisions. We give thanks for your direction in life. We thank you that you are faithful and true to everything that you have promised to us. And God, we magnify your name today. And we ask today that our worship of you would be worthy of your great and majestic name. God, we give praise to you today that when we couldn't see what was on the other side of that mountain, we had the assurance that it was good, because you were in control of everything. So God, may we continue to walk by faith. If another mountain rises in our pathway, may we know that we're just going up to worship the one true God. May we know that you are going to work all things together for good because you love us with an everlasting love. And God, may we inspire those who come behind us, those who walk alongside with us, that God, we believe you are the God who can do the impossible. Father, today, I pray if there's one who does not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, may today be the day that they rejoice because they put their faith and trust in Jesus and they're drawn to you. God, we give you this service. We pray that everything we say, everything we sing, everything we offer, and even our obedience to the truth that we discover in your word, may it all bring glory and honor to your name. We love you and we praise you. And we ask this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen and amen. Amen. Again, it's good to see you this morning in worship here at South River Baptist Church. And if you're visiting with us today, you're our special guest, and we're grateful that you chose to worship with us this morning. We just have one request of those who are visiting with us. If this is your first time, just remain seated so that our church family can welcome you into the house of the Lord. We do that by asking all of our church family to stand, to greet one another in the name of the Lord. Find someone you didn't get to say hello to this morning. Go introduce yourself or tell your mother or sister it's good to see him in the house of the Lord. So South River family, you do that at this time.
There's still a spot right there for you. All right, well, let's gather back together and let's give our praise to the Lord, who we know that we are assured in the faith that we have in Christ Jesus, because he has paid it all for us. And we look forward to that day that we stand before him and our faith is made sight.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, Lord of his Spirit. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song. Perfect submission.
to our assurance day by day, moment by moment, is that we stop when we don't have that faith, that trust in that moment. We give Him praise all day long.
Perfect submission, all is at rest. I am my Savior, am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled with His goodness, lost in His love.
We give praise to our Savior because He's the one that gives us that assurance we need. We don't have faith in faith itself. We don't have faith in the power of prayer. They're both powerful, but we have faith in Almighty God who gives us the way to trust Him. And we say with that man of the Gospels, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. We turn to the Lord and we realize that by His Word, He gives us trust. Because we can bank on the Word of God. When we open the Word of God, what happens, church? God speaks. And so be assured that God wants to speak to your heart today, right now, as we read His Word together. But you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, His own special people, that you may proclaim the praises of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light, who once were not a people, but are now the people of God, who had not obtained mercy, but now have obtained mercy. Beloved, I beg you, as sojourners and pilgrims, abstain from fleshly lusts which war against the soul, having your conduct honorable among the Gentiles, that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may, by your good works, which they observe, glorify God in the day of visitation. That day is coming when Jesus is going to come back. There will be a day when we all give account to the Lord. And thankfully, our account is under the blood of Christ. It's wiped away. It's forgiven by our faith in the Lord. We have much to praise Him for. So let's do that this morning and worship His holy name.
Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I worship Your
trust Him because He gave us a new day in which to live.
The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul. I worship Your holy name.
We worship him. He loves us with an everlasting love.
You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before.
We thank you. Thank you that you've made a way that we can worship you today and that we can worship you for eternity because we have placed our faith, our trust in Jesus and Jesus alone. Lord, thank you for the assurance that you give us as believers. Even though times may be dark and uncertain, we hold on to the hand of a God who is certain. And we know, Lord, not what the future holds, but we know who holds the future. As we continue to worship, Lord, help us to please you as we give, as we hear your word, and as we respond in obedience. Lord, help us to be people of faith who place all our trust in you. We love you. In Jesus' name.
Jenny's got more month than she's got money. Works three jobs, she's barely getting by. Bob got word his mom's been told it's cancer. So many questions, and all of them ask why.
We're living in a broken world, and a broken world won't give you any answers. Everything is upside down, wrong is right and right is wrong, but not for long, no, not for long. This broken world is cradled by a Savior, and nothing here can take him by surprise.
Someday all this hurting will be over, and every tear's been wiped away and dry. But for now, we're living in a broken world, but not for long. No, not for long. Mama spends her waking hours praying. Her child's done gone, left everything behind. Daddy's getting tired, his faith is fading. You can't get water from a well that's running dry. Living in a broken world, and a broken world won't give you any answers. Everything is upside down, wrong is right and right is wrong, but not for long, no, not for long. This broken world is cradled by a Savior, and nothing here can take him by surprise. Someday all this hurting will be over, and every tear's been wiped away and dry. But for now, we're living in a broken world, but not for long. No. And nothing here can take him by surprise. Someday all this hurting will be over, and every tear's been wiped away and dry. But for now, we're living in a broken world, but not for long. No. Alone. But for now, we're living in a broken world, but not for long. No, not for long.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Not for long. Amen. He's coming. He's coming soon. Maranatha, come, Lord Jesus, come. And I hope you have that expectation in your heart, looking forward to what God has in store for us. The children are running off to Children's Church, and we're running to God's Word this morning. In the book of Hebrews, if you'll be turning to Hebrews chapter 11, that great story of the Hall of Faith, and those who knew that God was faithful to His promises and His Word, and they looked afar off and saw what God had in store for them. And faith sees something out there in the future. It doesn't see just what's going on around it. It has to look out there into the future. And that's what we do as we walk by faith. I want you to look particularly today at verses 8 through 16. In a moment, we'll stand and read that. But I just want to ask you, it's 2020. How's your vision? Can you see 2020? I mean, I've got 20, I think 100, 2200, something like that. I'm nearsighted. I can't see far, right? They say you're farsighted, you can't see near. I've never understood that, how they got that backwards. But anyways, I've lived with it all my life, and it's never made sense to me. But sometimes, you know, I wish I could see further than 2020. How about you? And I mean, not just 2020. I mean the year 2020. I mean, there's some crazy things. Who would have thought we would have seen everything that's transpired in 2020, in 2019? And yet you have to wonder, even with all the chaos going on, how clearly do we actually see what's actually going on around us? Sometimes I wish I had spiritual glasses, not these physical ones, but spiritual ones that enabled me not to have the problem I have with these glasses where I'm nearsighted and I can't see far. In fact, when I take these off, you on the back row look so good. I just want you to know. And in the balcony. But if I had spiritual glasses on where I could see what God has in store for us, what's on the other side of the mountain that we sang about today, that mountain that's before us. I mean, there's a blurriness in the distance. There's an unknown, and that's why we walk by faith, trusting in the one who sees everything more clearly than we do. But to see the future spiritually and to know it as certain, confident in what God has promised, assured of what he has said. You know, even as we lead our children to grow and put their faith and trust in the Lord and put their whole lives in him and rest that he has these things and can see clearly for us. To know what's going to happen with that precious baby that God's entrusted to us and see what the future looks like for that child. To know what's going to happen to the company that you've poured your life into over these years, and there's uncertainty on the horizon. To know what's going to materialize from the relationship that we spend so much pursuing as a single person. The best way to see out in the future is to get a higher perspective, amen? You know, if you go out into the forest, you can't see that far because of the trees, but if you get into one of those towers and climb up in the tower, you can see out beyond much further, and you can even see the danger if there's a fire or something threatening the forest. If you go down to the city, the taller you go, the higher you go up in some of those tall buildings, you know, on the 74th floor up there, and you look out, you can see out beyond the urban mass that's there and see the suburban area and see further. And that's the same way with our God. We need a higher perspective. We need a grander view to see what's going on around us. And that's what God promises us when we dig into his word. It's the light of the word that illumines our path. It shows us the direction that we're going, the steps that we need to take. But in order for that really to impact our lives, you and I have to place our faith in what God has said, our trust in his promises, and rest in the one who has promised those things. You see, we've been walking with Abraham over the past couple months, and in order that we would learn to walk by faith as he did. He went out going, not knowing. And in fact, that's what God sometimes calls you and I to do when we take steps of faith. Personally and even corporately as a church. Next week when we gather at 10:45 a.m. to hear the 20-year vision for South River Baptist Church, we'll need to have faith like Abram going forward with eyes of faith, seeing and believing what we believe God has called us to do in a way that we would live our lives and pursue his glory in all that we do. I want to have unobscured vision to see clearly, like an eagle-eyed vision to see precisely this is the will of God, this is where he's leading us, to be attentive and alert so that as opportunities arise for me personally in my spiritual walk, for you in your spiritual walk, for us corporately as the body of Christ to realize this is what God has for us and we want to go for it with all that we have because we live by faith. You see, Abraham is a great example for us as one who walked by faith and with those spiritual eyes saw the unseen because he saw the hand of God before him and he heard the promises of God and he went forward in faith. In fact, this whole chapter is example after example of those who had no clear understanding of what was before him, but just had the promise of God, the word of God. I mean, even Noah, I mean, building a boat in the middle of nowhere because it's going to rain. What is rain? And doing that faithfully for 120 years until God sent the rain. And God sent the animals to fill the boat. All of these are examples of faith when you read down through this chapter. But we're going to pick up in verse 8 because I think there's some insight here about a summary of Abraham's life of faith that gives you and I, gives us insight about how you and I can see clearly in 2020 with spiritual eyes and see what's before us. And the decision we'll have to make individually, corporately, as believers, as to what we believe God is leading us to do. We need to see clearly in 2020. I mean, right now, there's a lot of darkness out there, and we need to see clearly, and only the light of God's word can illumine our darkness and show us the path ahead. And so we fix our eyes on him, and we ask him that he would give us eyes of faith like Abraham as we go forward to experience his blessings that he's promised to us. Stand with me in honor of the word of the Lord. We want to read this summary from verse 8 through 16 and gain some insights so that you and I can see with eyes of faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as an inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he dwelt in the land of promise, as in a foreign country, dwelling in tents and with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he waited for the city which has foundations, whose builder and maker is God. By faith, Sarah herself also received strength to conceive seed, and she bore a child when she was past the age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born as many as the stars of the sky in the multitude, innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. Now I'll focus on these verses. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. And truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out, they would have had opportunity to return. But now they desire a better, that is, a heavenly country. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. Will you pray with me? Open our eyes, Lord God, that we might see wonderful things out of thy law. That was David's prayer in Psalm 119. God, open our eyes that we might see wonderful things so that we walk by faith and we receive what you've promised. God, there is far more, there is far better, there is all that you have been preparing for us and for all those saints who walk by faith. God, we know we're closer than they are to that city. But God, we must walk as ambassadors of that city, pilgrims in this land. And we must walk by faith. And Lord, I pray that you would grant such faith to see what you have in store and believe it and embrace it. And God, today I pray you would embolden our faith, because the church needs to live this way in this day and in this age. We have a living hope, a blessed hope to share with the world in despair. God, help us to see it, believe it, and share it. We ask this in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. Amen. How can I see with eyes of faith? What does faith see? In verses 13 through 16, there's three things I believe that faith sees, and there's some insights here about how your faith and my faith needs to see in this day and the days ahead. And we need to inspire our children and grandchildren coming behind us and the world around us to choose to see with eyes of faith, because right now they can't see clearly. Sadly, much of the church appears to not see clearly what's ahead of us and what we need to be living for. How does faith see? Well, first, in verse 13, it says that my faith sees far off. Our eyes don't just see what's happening in the here and now. Our eyes see far off in the distance. All of these, it's written, they died in faith, not having received the promises, but notice this, but having seen them afar off, were assured of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on this earth. You trace the verbs here because they're key. Our faith sees and understands. These having seen at some point, God spoke to them, gave them a precious promise, and said, choose to see what I'm showing you. They hadn't seen it. Noah didn't see the flood, but he had the word, build an ark. Abraham didn't know the land where he was going, but he saw it afar off. Sarai didn't know how she was going to conceive, but she believed in the one who was faithful. All these, having the promises, saw them far off as possible. You see, the church today is not attempting because it doesn't believe God can do the impossible. There's impossible things before us, and the church has lost its faith in the one who is able to do the impossible. And we're not believing the promises of God's word. We're not assured of them. We're not embracing them. And we're not confessing them and going forward. We need to see afar off with long-range vision. And I don't just mean to 2021. I mean they saw afar off all the way to the future, to the city that God was building for them. It's not so much a distance of space that they're talking about, a physical distance. They're talking about a physical time even, where they saw that God was faithful to everything that he had promised in his word. And beloved, you and I need to live like that. That God is faithful to every promise he's made, and that we too are like them, walking to a land we don't know. A land that awaits us on the other side of the river. A land that awaits us so we don't fear death, because that's the doorway that takes us into that promised land. And we are assured of those things because, like them, we know the one who has promised. God had brought them a far distance. He brought them from Ur of the Chaldees. They traveled over whatever was over those sand dunes, over that mighty expanse of wilderness, some 500 plus miles. And they went forward in faith. They had to believe. And it took faith to walk out into that wilderness, out into that desert, and to believe there was something better on the other side. But they saw beyond that. They saw a city, an eternal city, a city whose builder was God, and they knew he was faithful and able to build what he had promised and supply it to them. Some of y'all right now are saying, Pastor, I'm having a hard time seeing past today to tomorrow. Clouds of darkness because of circumstances and situations that you have no control over, and saying, Pastor, I don't even know how I'm going to see past that. Well, you see, that's when you have to get a higher perspective. You have to run to the tower of the name of the Lord and start going up and pressing some buttons and getting up a little bit higher and realizing he's faithful to his name and everything he's promised in his word, and say, I want to see from your perspective because mine is so limited down here on earth. You see, they saw God, they heard God speak, and in similar fashion, I have to do the same thing. You say, well, it'd be a lot easier if I had God speak to me like Abraham did. I mean, God even appeared to him with a couple of angels, right? If I just had that, Pastor, it'd be easier for me. You know, that's not true. Do you realize you can be, like, right in the same setting with God and not see? Think about Jesus and the Pharisees. Think about Jesus and many of those who saw the miracles that he did. Many of them were right there, and they didn't believe. And they didn't benefit from their vision even of the God who dwelt in flesh. In fact, what Jesus said is, they have Moses and the prophets. That's enough. Beloved, we got Moses and the prophets and the Gospels and the Epistles and the Apocalypse. We've got the whole story, far more than they do. They saw far off. We're closer, and we're even limited by what we see because we're not taking God at his word and believing he is who he says he is. You see, God has spoken to us in a living word just as he has to Abram. This word, Hebrews will emphasize that. This book is a living word. It's active, sharper than a two-edged sword. It pierces right within the soul. It exposes us, and it helps unveil where we have unbelief and expose that, so instead we can choose to not despise the word but put our faith and trust in the word. In fact, all throughout this epistle that Paul wrote, there's a progression that goes from not living with a heart of rebellion and rejecting and despising what God has said, but maturing in our faith and growing in our faith, so that even when difficult times come, as we see the day approaching, we don't forsake the assembling of the brethren together, but we draw close to one another and we encourage one another with what God has said, because we've seen afar off. And we know he's faithful to what he's promised us. And you look on the horizon today of ecclesiology within just America, the churches today, shuttering their doors and closing their doors and saying, I guess we have nothing to offer them. We have nothing to believe in. You ask yourself what is happening today, and what needs to happen today is, in times of despair, the doors of the church should be open so that we can say there's something afar off, far better than what we have now. You see, they were assured of them. Why were they assured of them? Because they knew the one who promised. They considered him faithful. They trusted in him. It's not just that they had the promises of God. They had the God who promises. And that's what we need today. Some people have the word of God, but I wonder sometimes if they've got the God of the word. And they know who he is, and that he is faithful, and that he's pledged himself and promised himself, and he alone is able to make it come to pass. We're living as though it all depends on us. It doesn't, beloved. It depends on him. Our faith and our trust rest in him. They possessed an absolute confidence in him. They knew that he was faithful to what he promised, and they trusted him. You see, even Abraham didn't get to see a lot of miracles. We have no evidence of that. All he had was the word of God. So many people saying, if I just had some miraculous sign, I would believe. Abraham just had the word. Oh yeah, he saw something pretty miraculous. He saw God smoke Sodom and Gomorrah. But that was later. That was after he had put his faith and believed in God. He saw God do something miraculous. They conceived, Sarai conceived and had Isaac. But that was after he took God at his word. So many people wanting a sign. Abraham didn't need it. He just went forward in faith, believing and taking God at his word. You see, this word is a faithful testimony of the God who spoke it. Over in chapter 6 of Hebrews, in verses 13 and then 16 through 18, God pledges that he made, as it says in Hebrews 6:13, for when God made promises to Abraham, because he could swear by no greater, he swore by himself. You see, God says, I'm true, and what I promise is true, and I will be faithful to complete what I say. In verses 16 through 18 of Hebrews 6, God says that he spoke these things to the heirs of promise because of the immutability of his counsel, and he confirmed it by an oath. That God pledged these things by his counsel. The thus saith the Lord, you can take it to the bank, in other words. Wherever you find that in the Bible, thus saith the Lord, that's his counsel. His counsel is so much better than our counsel, and it is worth putting your faith and your trust in. And then God gave an oath. He pledged himself. He made a pledge because man's oath, men don't always complete their oath. Men aren't always faithful to what they vow. But God is not a man. God is one who does not lie. God is faithful and God is true. And when he speaks, he pledges himself and he gives the assurance that he will bring it to pass. I mean, we just sang Blessed Assurance. Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. You see, our faith sees afar off. We've just had a small taste. Beloved, there's a banquet that awaits us that's far better. Because we'll see then as he is. But right now, we're walking by faith. And yet, if we really see afar off, we realize we've got something still to live for. There's no reason to shut down our lives and shut down our ministries and stop serving the Lord. We got to embrace these promises that God has given. Not with a reluctant acceptance. Well, yeah, he's promised that. No. The picture is they saw them. They were certain of them because of who God is. And they embraced them. Oh, I want this so much. I wonder, just as churches are shuttering their doors, do they really want what God has for them after this world? Because we have essentially said we have nothing to communicate about our faith to the world around us because we're living in fear. But if our God is in control and he is genuinely our shepherd, then what we know is, I fear no evil. And that includes in the valley of the shadow of death. And may I say, COVID-19 is not even the shadow of death. It's nowhere, no worse than the flu, statistically. If we're even been told the right statistics. The problem is this. We're not taking God at his word. We're not going forward in faith. We're not embracing it joyfully, enthusiastically, believing in the one who has promised it. And so in some ways, we're not even looking afar off. All we're doing right now is looking to the latest headline and the latest statistic and saying, oh my. But see, their eyes saw further. They saw it afar off, and they realized, they confessed, we're just strangers in this land anyways. We're not living for this world. You see, that's what faith does. It doesn't just see far off. It also sees far more. Verses 14 and 15. For those who say such things declare plainly that they seek a homeland. Why? Truly, if they had called to mind that country from which they had come out of, they would have had opportunity to return. In other words, they saw far off what God had in store for them, and they went forward in faith. And they realized that the world that they were in, their present situation, did not have as much to offer as the one that was to come. And they realized, this world is not my home. There's far more waiting for me on the other side. There's far more waiting for me that is going to enrich my lives. Abraham wasn't thinking about the stuff he left behind in Ur of the Chaldees. He was looking further, farther off to see what God had in store for him. And so as a sojourner, a stranger, he went forward. And everywhere he went, he pitched his tent and he built his altar. He went forward as a wanderer, going at the leading of the hand of the Lord. And then wherever he got, he knew, God's with me and I'm going to worship him. Pilgrims and priests, just as you would read there in the whole epistle of 1 Peter. And that's key. In order to go forward, you can't look back. Faith looks afar off, and it knows that there is far more on the other side, and it goes forward. You know, I've had the joy of teaching my children to drive. I'm now on number 5, and I still have hair. And I know when I get into my truck to teach them how to drive, you know, make sure they put the seat belt on, adjust the seat, turn on the air conditioning, especially now in the summer. Help them understand which is the gear shift, which is the turn signal indicator. Make certain they know where the brake pedal is. And then, you know, you look at the mirrors and you adjust them and make sure they're just right. And you explain to them the purpose of the mirrors. But to effectively drive, so dad doesn't grab that handle up there, you don't look in the rearview mirror all the time. You look forward, and you go forward, and you drive forward. You might occasionally glance in the mirrors, but to effectively go forward, you have to look straight ahead. And in our personal spiritual life, in our corporate life of a church, the great danger in going forward is wanting to look in the mirrors too much. And see what's behind us, what's beside us, instead of just going forward in faith. And in order for us to go forward in faith, and in order for you to go forward in faith in your personal walk, some of you need to put the things behind you. You don't need to worry about the things beside you. And you need to go forward and trust the Lord. And that's where the church is today. We need to see that there's far more ahead of us because of what he's promised us. And not look back to the pack and think about what we left behind. Nor look to the side and consider what they have or don't have, or what we have or don't have. But to go forward in faith and choose to believe God has more for us, and we walk in faith. You know, that's what Jesus said when he called individuals to follow him. To not worry about their job, their family, but just to grab the plow and go forward in faith. Even Paul, his testimony over in the book of Philippians, chapter 3. Forgetting those things behind, he did what? He pressed forward. And he went forward in faith. And some of y'all, we need a good, swift kick to go forward. Because we're standing still and not moving right now. And the church needs that ever gentle prodding of the Spirit of God to go forward in faith. And say, now's the time to attempt great things for God. Now's the time for us to live as bright lights, confident that there's something afar off for us worth going after, and there's something far more that it has to offer. Do you know what's sad? For so long, the church has had everything that we've been seeking, nothing that God wanted. We've had everything that we sought, nothing. And now, in some ways, the Creator God has said, I'm taking everything away. Let's see if you want what I've got for you. And God's trying to arrest our attention and say, focus your vision on me and go forward in faith. And that's what faith does. It sees afar off, and it sees there's far more over there. I mean, do you believe there's far more over there? I mean, if we really believe there's far more over there, it's not just that we believe there's far more, we believe it's far better. Amen? I mean, this world is not our home. That's how they live. They desired, verse 16, they desired a better, that is a heavenly country. Not Ur the Chaldees. They wanted the better that God had for them. They wanted the more that God had for them. They wanted what was on the other side. That's what faith does. And it seeks with understanding. God, I'm persuaded, I'm convinced, I've embraced the promises that you have. And I go forward in faith, and I contemplate, and I think about, this is who you are. This is what you've promised. This is the God that I worship. This is how you revealed yourself. And you know what? Even when I get down in the dumps of life, I go forward in faith because I know him and what he's promised me. And I'm persuaded that he will do what he has said. But you know what? You won't be persuaded to even consider what he has said if you don't embrace what he said. If you don't meditate on what he said. And all they had was the word to meditate on. They only had a few words. Beloved, we got the whole book. We got the whole story. It's right there for us to go forward. But they had such little word, just a few words, and yet it was enough for them to confess their identity as the people of God. God is not ashamed to be called their God because they realized we're his people. Our allegiance is to him. Our faith is in him. We're strangers. We're pilgrims. Our manner of conduct, our manner of living is that we're just on a journey. This world is not my home. My home is elsewhere. And I'm desiring, earnestly pressing toward, living for heaven. You see, in some ways right now, it's a wake-up call for the church to realize, what have we really been living for? What has been the priority of our life? What has been the priority of our finances? What has been the priority of our daily living? What has been the priority as we experience hardships and difficulties? Do we believe what God has said? Will we continue to believe what God has said? And will we press forward to say, I want the more, the better that he has in store? And it's not just over the horizon. It's even further than that. We can't even see that far where he is and all he's assured us. I mean, praise God, Jesus has promised us a room in Father's house. Amen? And that awaits us, and we live for that, and we look forward to that. But if we really have that living hope, why aren't we sharing that with the world around us? Why are we silent? Why are we shuttering the doors? Why is not the church engaging the culture and saying, oh, we've got a living hope. We've got nothing to fear. And yet you have to wonder, do we really believe it? Do we really believe what God has said? You see, because if I have authentic, genuine faith, my faith sees far off, my faith sees far more, and my faith sees there's far better that awaits me. And so I'm going forward in faith. You know, believing is actually seeing. And without faith, you will not be able to see that far ahead. Now that may sound backwards, believing is seeing. And for all the doubting Thomases, that is true. Because for Thomas, it was what? Seeing is believing. And yet the promise Jesus said is, hey, listen, Thomas, there are those who haven't even seen, and they're even more blessed because they see with eyes of faith. You see, it may sound backwards, believing is seeing, but that's what God's word says to us. It's actually, you hear what God says, you choose to believe what God says, and then with eyes of faith, you see what he has for you, and you go forward in faith. I think that's fascinating because when you come over to Psalm 19 and to Psalm 119, what you discover in those songs that David wrote and penned about the Word of God That it's the light of God's word. It illumines the mind. It illumines our understanding. It illumines the pathway. It illumines the direction we need to go, the steps we need to take. Believing is seeing. And without faith, it's impossible to please Him. You have to believe what God has said. I even remember Jesus saying to Mary that if you will believe, you will see. And see, some of us in this morning today need to get on the altar and say, God, I've not been seeing with eyes of faith because I've not been believing what your word says. And see, faith is forsaking all to trust Him. And today, you and I will not see clearly until we exercise faith. And we choose to believe God is faithful to what He has promised. If there's ever a time for the church to walk by faith and to live by faith, it's today. The world desperately needs to see you and I going forward in faith, not cowering in fear. They need to see that we have a faith that is unshakable. We possess a faith that will not be wavering in unbelief in any way. We're going forward. Not just because I have the Word of God, but I've got the God of the Word. And I'm His, and He's mine. And I'm going forward believing He's faithful to what He's promised. You see, you need to possess that kind of faith today. But really, it's not that I need to possess it. It needs to possess me. You say, oh, preacher, talking about being possessed. Hold up. I'm talking about convictions that grip us. That, you know what? I don't hold on to it. It holds on to me. And I am confident. I am assured. I have embraced it. I have said, it is my confession. I know what I believe. And I'm going forward in faith. You say, how do I get that? You got to believe in the Word. Not just the written Word, but the living Word. The living Word is Jesus. God spoke to us, as Hebrews 1 says, in this final word. Clear presentation of who God is. And this book, these Gospels and Epistles, they all point to Him. The Old Testament points to Him. You and I are believing in the Word of God and trusting in Him. And trusting that He is faithful to everything that He has promised us in this Word. And you can take it to the bank. And that's how you need to live each and every day. You get up in the morning and you say, Word of God, speak to me. Spirit of God, who inspired this word, illumine my mind and help me to understand the precious promises that you have written within. And God, help me to take a step of faith and trust you today. And some of us, God is saying to you right now, you need to take a greater step of faith. And you need to see and believe. You see, we know more of the story. We actually know the end of the story. We see in the Word the faithfulness of God. And we've seen that at times in our life. But church, I'm calling you right now. Now is the time to go forward in faith and not shirk back. You see, He'll keep His Word because He's faithful and He's true. And when I read that last chapter of Revelation, the one who appears on the horse that comes to His name, it says, is faithful and true. Praise God, He hadn't changed. Praise God, He's consistent to what He says. And you and I could today can take it to the bank. The first step is to receive His Word, His Son Jesus. When you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior, confessing you're a sinner and you can't save yourself, the Bible says that God saves you. And when He saves you, He gives you His Spirit, who helps you then to understand His Word and to go forward in faith each day, trusting in what He has said, believing in what He has said, growing in your faith in what He has said. And that's the faith that we invite you to embrace today, if you've never embraced it. For some who put their faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you need to follow the Lord in believer's baptism, as four students will do in the next service, celebrating that they have trusted in the Word of God, in Jesus, and what He has done, dying for their sins and purchasing their pardon for their sins and trusting in Him to be their righteousness. Maybe you need to do that today. Maybe God is leading you to take a step of faith in some decision you need to in your personal walk, and you need to put it here on the altar and leave it here, some mountain that's before you that seems impossible, and you're just going to take God at His word and say, I choose to believe you are who you say you are. You'll work this together for good, and I'm going to leave it with you and trust you. Everyone today needs to take a step of faith. And church, we must demonstrate this faith to a world around us because they're desperate, and we're not. We're desperate for God and what He has for us. We're not desperate because of the circumstances around us. So I challenge you today, walk by faith and see all that God has in store for us. Will you close your eyes with me for a moment and bow your heads and ask that God's Spirit would have His way in your heart right now, that the word that you would have heard today, that you would make whatever decision is that you need to make in faith, trusting in Him.